It's half past 8.
It's 8:30 New York time. Time to wake up America and stump the experts. Every week at this time, Lucky Strike presents a quartet of wiseacres who challenge you to baffle them. For every question we use, Lucky Strike pays out $10 plus a copy of the new Information Please quiz book. If your question stumps us, you get $25 more plus a 24-volume set of the current Encyclopedia Britannica. Send your questions to Information Please, 480 Lexington Avenue, New York City. If our editorial staff edits your questions a bit, don't fret over it. In case of duplications, Information Please uses the question that was received first. And all questions become the property of Information Please. And now light up a lucky strike as I present our master of ceremonies, the distinguished composer, music critic, and commentator, Deems Taylor. Mr. Taylor.
Ladies and gentlemen, that slight rattling noise that you may have heard just now was merely myself preparing to fill the shoes of Clifton Fadiman for one consecutive performance of Information, Please. Appearing on this unrehearsed and uncoached program tonight are our three regular experts, John Kieran, authority on sports, cooking, ornithology, or what you will, Franklin P. Adams, conductor of the New York Post's famous column, The Conning Tower, and authority on everything else, and Oscar Levant, whose vast store of musical knowledge has long been a source of amazement and annoyance to friend and foe alike. We also have a guest, John Ohara, novelist and playwright, whose latest, the musical comedy Pal Joey, is packing them in at the Ethel Barrymore Theater at this very moment. Remember, for every question that is missed, Lucky Strike rings up $25, which is paid out to the sender, plus 24 volumes of the Encyclopedia Britannica. And now, gentlemen, on your marks. Our first question comes from Leonard Lyons of New York City. And we have to get 4 out of 4 on this. It's about columns. What is the name of the column written by H.I. Phillips? Mr. Kieran.
The Sundial.
Any particular paper?
The Sun.
I mean, in New York.
Oh, in New York.
Yes. Damon Runyon. Damon Runyon.
It's just Damon Runyon, isn't it, with a picture with glasses on?
Well, it has a picture with glasses on, and it probably is Damon Runyon, but it also has a title. It's,
My God, I don't want Leonard to get a set of encyclopedias.
Might help him.
But, I could ask you what's the name of Mr. Lyons' column, but...
I know that. Lyons' Den.
Yes, but unfortunately, that isn't one of the questions.
No.
We want to know the name of Mr. Runyon's column.
Speaking out, or...
For myself?
Not exactly. Perhaps we'd better go on to the next and come back to that. Mr. Walter Lippmann's column. Mr. Adams.
Today and tomorrow.
In
the New York Tribune and I don't know how many other papers.
Yes. Walter Winchell. Mr. O'Hara.
Broadway. Your Broadway and mine used to be column.
No, there's
Walter Winchell on Broadway.
That duet by Mr. Adams and Mr. O'Hara was correct. Now we still have Mr. Runyon's column to name.
As I See It or As Damon Runyon Sees It.
I don't think he has a title.
Well, I'm afraid that that is going to cost Lucky Strike $25 and a set of the Encyclopedia Britannica. The name of Mr. Runyon's column is The Brighter Side, as all of you gentlemen instantly recollect, I'm sure.
That must be pretty embarrassing for Damon.
It's embarrassing for us, we see.
Well, I think it was more embarrassing to Lucky Strike, if you ask me. Now, our next question, of which we must get 2 out of 3, comes from Mary Cole of Marshall, Illinois. In what work of fiction, or the theater, does the jury consist of members of the audience? Mr. Levant.
There was a play presented by Al Woods called January the 16th, the night of January the 16th.
By?
By,
Damon Runyon.
No.
No, Mr. Adams. It's still not Damon Runyon.
I don't know who it's by.
Well,
I think it was...
Mr. O'Hara?
Bayard Vaillé, wasn't it?
Right. The night of January 16th by Bayard Vaillé. Between you, you're utterly correct.
I'm glad I didn't know it. I couldn't pronounce Bayard Vaillé's name anyway.
Well, that, In what work, and also in what work of fiction or the theater, does the jury consist of the ghosts of disgraced Americans? Mr. Levant.
I wasn't here. I'll take a guess. I better not. I was going to say the play by Philip Barry, but I better not.
I think you'd better not. Oh, you don't know how you'd better not.
A play by Sidney Howard.
Mr. Levant, a play by Sidney Howard. Well, that's a brave effort.
You know which play I mean.
Ah, but do you?
It's about Ethel Barrymore was in it.
Well, she's in practically all plays that are...
Only one play of Sidney
Howard. Good.
Well,
unfortunately, this isn't a play by Sidney
all right,
Howard.
Thank you.
Well, while you're thinking that one over, how about the work in which the jury consists of birds and animals, Mr. Kieran?
That's in Alice in Wonderland, the trial of the Knave of Hearts, I believe, for stealing the tarts.
Yes, that's true.
With lizards in there and frogs.
Bill
and
the lizard, yes. He came down the chimney. But you still haven't got those disgraced Americans.
It wasn't by Elmer Rice, was it?
No, indeed. You know, it isn't necessarily a play.
Oh, I see.
It says work of fiction or the theater.
Oh, I see.
I see looks of vast discouragement on your faces, gentlemen, and a look of maniacal look of triumph on the name of the on the face of the cash register operator as Mr. O'Hara thinks it's...
Could it have been a picture? Is that eligible?
No, as a matter of fact, I'm wrong. We've won. We only had to get 2 out of 3 on that. So I worried you gentlemen unnecessarily. It's The Devil and Daniel Webster by Stephen Vincent Benet.
Well, that was an opera. Subsequently.
But it was originally a poem. Now one comes from Beverly Hills, from Marvin C. Park. Again, we have to get 2 out of 3. And I hope I remember it this time. The question is, explain the peculiarities in migration of the following, of the lemmings. Mr. Kieran.
Well, the lemmings migrate occasionally when they become overpopulous in a district, and nothing gets them is allowed to halt their migration, and the story is that a great many plunge into the sea and are drowned. I'm not so sure about it. Myself, I never investigated. Lemming is a small
animal. You never
asked
a lemming.
Belonging to the mouse family.
Do you know what part of the world? Mr. O'Hara.
The Rats of Norway was written about them, wasn't it?
I believe it was, yes. Yes, they're supposed to be Scandinavian rodents. At intervals of 5 to 20 years, a whole generation goes and leaps into the ocean.
The Baltic Sea, I believe.
Into the Baltic Sea, yes. Now, what about eels? What's peculiar about their migration, Mr. Kieran?
The eels migrate to the ocean to spawn, and they never come back. As a matter of fact, the life cycle of the eels is still a mystery to ichthyologists.
Meaning fishermen.
Well, they're taken up by the fish experts, although they are a little different from the ordinary fish.
Well, they're if they never come back, how do we have any eels?
The young come back.
Oh, the young come back. Well, that's about the only fish that does alternate between fresh and salt water, isn't it?
Oh, no. Some other fish will run up the rivers as far as fresh water.
Just for a drink. Now, the peculiarity of the Arctic tern. The tern, Mr. Kieran?
Well, there's nothing peculiar about it except the distance. It probably makes the longest migration of any bird or animal or insect in the world. It nests in the northern polar regions and spends the winter at the other end of the world.
Well, that's rather a trip, isn't it? I suppose
not
that's
for a tern.
Oh. I suppose that they think one good tern... well, now the next one concerns people who hit the jackpot twice. This comes from Harry Chapman of Milwaukee, Wisconsin. We have to get 3 out of 4 on this, gentleman. For what 2 novels did Booth Tarkington win the Pulitzer Prize? He won it twice, you know. With 2 novels.
Wasn't the Magnificent Ambersons, was it?
You're making me very happy, Mr. Levant.
It was, huh?
Yes. Huh? Mr. Adams.
And Alice Adams.
You ought to know that, Mr. Adams. But,
story of his life.
You gentlemen have no idea of the dates, of course, but that's not necessary.
Ambersons was
Mr. O'Hara?
I'll guess on Adams. 1924.
Well, if...
As long before that, I think.
Not long, well, 2 years.
Oh.
Two years before, and the Ambersons were 1919. For what two plays did Eugene O'Neill win the Pulitzer Prize, Mr. Levant?
Strange Interlude, number one.
Yes.
Number two, the boys ought to be thinking.
Yes.
Harry Ape?
No, Mr. Levant. We need another, Mr. O'Hara.
Oh, was that family play about New Britain?
Our Wilderness.
Our Wilderness.
Well, if you'll just name over all of O'Neill's plays, you're bound to hit one of them. No, Mr. Ryan.
Our Wilderness again.
Mr. Levant. We need a play.
Beyond
now.
The Horizon.
That's right, Mr. Adams. Perfect. And he also, he won it three times, as a matter of fact. He won it with Anna Christie in another year, in 1922. For what novel and what play did Thornton Wilder win the Pulitzer Prize, Mr. Levant?
The Bridge of St. Louis Ray. Our Town. Yeah.
Disposes of that question in practically no time at all.
I thought he won it with the novel, Bridge of St. Louis Ray.
Yes, well, he won it twice. He won it with the Bridge of St. Louis Ray, he said in my good Spanish, in 1928, and Our Town in 1938.
Uh-huh.
For what two plays did Robert Sherwood win the Pulitzer Prize, Mr. Levant?
Idiot's Delight.
Yes.
And he didn't win it with There Shall Be No Nights, so I'll have to think.
No, he didn't. Mr. Adams.
Abraham Lincoln in Illinois.
Gentlemen, you are wonderful. You've answered all four. I cannot express my admiration any better than by going on to the next question, which comes from Max White of New York City. We have to get all three of these. It concerns foreign relations committees. I see a look of apprehension on your furrowed brows already. Name the chairman of the Senate Foreign Relations Committee, Mr. Levant.
Well, isn't that Senator George of Georgia?
Is absolutely right, Mr. Levant. You're a pillar of strength this evening. For a man who knows so much about music, I don't know how you...
I don't know much about music.
Oh, well, that explains it. number two, name the ranking Republican member of the Senate Foreign Relations Committee. The ranking Republican member.
Well, ranking can be taken many ways.
When senators talk to one another, it only means one thing. The senior Republican member of the Senate Foreign Relations Committee. Oh, gentlemen, don't betray me like this.
Give me the initial.
X.
What?
Senator Johnson of California?
Who?
Senator Johnson of California.
Perfect. Wonderful. Number three is named the chairman of the House Foreign Relations Committee, Mr. Levant.
Hamilton Fish.
No, Mr. Levant. You
said the House.
I did say the House.
Well, I'm glad I'm wrong in a way.
Mr. O'Hara. Mr. O'Hara.
Mr. Martin of Massachusetts.
No, that's reasonable, but not correct.
How about Tinkham?
Well, how about him? Nope. Oh, I'm afraid that's $25 more for Mr. Max White and a set of the Encyclopedia Britannica. It was Congressman Sol Bloom. Now, we're going to have three proposals, and you have to identify two of them. They're from three plays. Now, here's the first.
I've only got a minute, maybe less than that. I love you. I know it's awful sudden, but in a minute it'll be too late. Let's elope. Let's get out of here.
But wait a minute. You don't know me.
I know you better than those other girls. You can make corn muffins, and you're darn cute looking, and I love you.
But I don't know you.
Mr. Levant.
It's of the I Sing.
Right.
Corn muffins tipped it.
No, leave out corn muffins next time.
I wouldn't
time.
Have known.
Here's the next one. Play.
I will not marry you. I will not marry you.
Oh, you will. You will.
I tell you no, no, no.
I tell you yes, yes.
No, no, no.
Yes. Before it is too late for repentance. Yes.
When did all this happen to me before? Are we too dreamy?
No. We're...
And you have said pardon me,
no,
company.
That is all.
Well?
Well, I made a mistake. You do not love me.
It is false. I love you.
Gentlemen?
Was Private Lives wrong?
Private Lives was utterly wrong, yes.
Mm-hmm.
It's a much older play than Private Lives.
Older?
Oh, years older.
I won't even think then.
Well, I saw it when I was a senior in college. Well, that is from Man and Superman.
Oh.
By George Bernard Shaw. Now, here's the third.
I'd be proud as a king to make love to you like a Georgian.
Honey, do I understand you're proposing to me?
If I said, would you marry me now? You'd say no.
No, I wouldn't.
Yes, you would.
No, I wouldn't. How could I, Sugarfoot, when you're just sweeping me off my feet?
You mean?
I'm taking...
Yes?
It's merely because of its southern, and it isn't kiss the boys goodbye, so it probably might be coquette.
I see. As a matter of fact, has anyone else a guess on that? No opinions from the jury. As a matter of fact, it is from kiss the boys goodbye. In which Mr. Levant had just appeared in the screen
picture.
Version.
Well, that's enough.
And the role of was played this evening by Miss Helen Clare, who played the role in New York all.
I'm sorry.
A few years ago. So.
But there's a reason for my being confused. I don't have to say anything.
Well, Lucky Strike announces a loss of $50 and two sets of the Encyclopedia Britannica on our halfway through our journey. And now here's Mr. Cross with a question.
Who really buys the finer, lighter, milder tobaccos at the auctions? The surest answer, I believe, is to be found in the actual reports from tobacco markets. Now, I want to read you some typical reports. For instance, at tobacco auctions in Danville, Virginia during the past season, the American Tobacco Company paid 44% more per pound for the tobacco it bought for its cigarettes and other tobacco products. Yes, 44% above the average market price paid for all the various types and grades of tobacco sold there. And the best we bought will go to Lucky's. On the same basis, at Farmville, North Carolina, American paid 49% more. And at Pamplico, South Carolina, 54% more. And so it goes at market after market. Lucky Strike consistently pays higher prices to get the finer, the lighter, the naturally milder leaf. Isn't that fact worth remembering next time you buy cigarettes?
Well, unaccustomed as I am to public timing, Mr. Cross, my watch says that it took you just 59 seconds. Now we open the second half of the program with a question from Roger Stanley of Boonville, Mississippi. Quote four lines of poetry, that is four separate lines, which mention either east or west. Mr. Adams.
East is east and west is west, and never the twain shall meet.
Correct. And please don't go on.
That's anyone about else? All I know in poetry.
Mr. Karen.
Westward the course of empire takes its way.
Well,
westward the star of empire takes its way.
Well, while you gentlemen are wrangling, won't somebody else give me another? Because westward isn't... there are so many poems with you. Mr. Adams again.
Three fishers went sailing away to the west.
Perfect. Mr. Kieran?
Oh, young Lochinvar has come out of the west.
Mr. Levant?
Well, Mr. Kieran will have to help me out. It's on the road to Mandalay. There's some thunderous line about east of something.
Somewhere east of Suez.
There it
the
is.
The west is like the worst.
There it is. Well, we have a whole compass there. I think we might go on to geography now. This comes from Stuart Sherman of Forest Hills, New York. We have to get three out of four on this. What city is across the water from Superior, Wisconsin? Mr. Adams.
Duluth.
Minnesota, on Lake Superior. Quite right. Covington, Kentucky. Mr. O'Hara.
Cincinnati.
Right.
Ohio.
Right. Ohio River. Oakland, California. Mr. Levant?
San Francisco.
In what state, Mr. Levant?
We call it Cal with a period.
Oh, Cal. what city is across the water from Edgewater, New Jersey? That's rather difficult. Mr. O'Hara?
New York.
Right you are. Now, a bit of musical sleuthing. And if Mr. Levant doesn't answer this, I shall have to. The pianist will play a passage from a work by Beethoven. Mr. Levant is to identify it and then play a similar passage that occurs in a more familiar Beethoven composition. Is Mr. Levant conversant with that question? Passage from a work by Beethoven. Mr. Levant is to identify it and then play a similar passage from a more familiar work by Beethoven. Gentlemen.
It's by Beethoven. I don't know what that
so
is.
So far, you're perfect, Mr. Levant.
I really don't know.
You don't? Well, it's from the violin sonata in G major.
Well, he played it in E-flat, I thought.
Oh, well, that's probably
all right, but I don't know it.
All right, the next...
like that? If you tell me what's like it, maybe I'll know. What's similar to that?
Oh, well, what's like it is a passage from the first movement of the piano sonata in A-flat, opus 110.
Oh, yeah, wait. I'm playing the 16th notes twice.
I know. Well, you win on a post-mortem. All right, the next selection. Yes, Mr. Levant?
Well, I'll play the well-known one.
Yes. That's right. What do you have to...
That's that one of the easy Beethoven sonatas. It's called... That's the title of it, one of the two easy ones.
Yes, I think it is. No, but the first selection is not from a sonata.
Well, there's a record of a septet.
That's it.
With a horn in it, I remember.
Yes, it sounds like nose and throat trouble, but mm-hmm. Now the last example. Yeah, and what was the first one?
Well, you're a musician, Mr. Taylor.
Well, I think that's extraordinary. I think we'll give you 2 out of 3 on that. Now, here's a single question that has to be answered at a gulp. It comes from Saul Gertz of Brooklyn, New York. In a Major League Baseball game, and this is a fact, the batting averages of the entire losing team were the same after the game as they were before it began. Explain how this could happen. Mr. Levant.
If the times at bat, if it was 500. Oh, no, I'm wrong. I was thinking out loud again. You know what that
happened. Never do that. Never think out. Never think, as a matter of fact. Mr. Kieran is so exhausted by...
A legal game, is that?
Oh, yes. It's a game that actually occurred. And the batting averages of the members of the losing team were the same after the game as before the game. Mr. O'Hara.
Well, I don't know very much about baseball, but I think this would do it. Man gets on base through baseline balls, which I don't believe is a time at bat, and steals home.
Well, that's the whole team.
No, Mr. Adams.
That could be the first game of the season.
Ah, also. Come on, Mr. Adams.
And all the members of the losing team could bet 0-0-0.
That's exactly what happened.
Bob Feller pitched the game.
That's absolutely
on the
it.
Of the season.
Yes.
A no-hit game.
In the opening game of the season of April of 1940, Mr. Feller pitched a no-hit game against Chicago. And the batting averages of the players being 0-0-0, it remained the same after the game. Gentlemen, and Mr. Adams in particular, you're wonderful. A question from Annie L. Fager of Havana, Illinois. This concerns gambling and poetry, with which I'm sure all you gentlemen are conversant. We have to get 3 out of 4. In what gambling scenes in poetry or prose literature were the following at stake? First, kisses. Mr. Kieran.
Cupid and Campaspe played by Lyly.
My Campaspe.
I was betting myself that you wouldn't get that, Mr. Kieran. Mm-hmm. And you did. At cards for kisses, Cupid paid. In what gambling scene was a servant the stake?
Oh.
Mr. Levant?
That's Ruggles.
That's right.
Ruggles of Red Gap.
Yes. The servant was? A valet.
Yeah, Ruggles.
In what gambling scene was a man's life at stake? Mr. Kieran?
In Girl of the Golden West.
That's true, too. Although that isn't the answer given here, but it's quite right. The answer, here is in the Rime of the Ancient Mariner. In what gambling scene...
A dice for death.
Yes. In what betting contest were 6 Barbary horses wagered against 6 French rapiers?
That's in the Three Musketeers, wasn't it?
No, it's in Hamlet. Theme between Laertes and Hamlet. A brief one on politics. When each of these presidential candidates lost, Who won? This comes from Mrs. Walter Young of New York, and we have to get 2 out of 3. Well, when William Jennings Bryan lost, who won? Mr. Levant.
Mr. Adams.
Mr. Adams.
William McKinley.
Right. And someone else.
Theodore Roosevelt.
Nope.
Grover Cleveland.
We haven't time to name all the presidents.
W.H. Taft.
That's right, Mr. Adams. When Horace Greeley lost, who won?
Oh.
Yes?
General Grant.
Right. When George B. McClellan lost, who won? Mr. Adams.
Abraham Lincoln.
That's absolutely correct, gentlemen. I have one on meals I hope we have time for. Identify these fictional meals and who ate them. A large pickle, raspberry lemonade, a box of sardines, half pint of lukewarm cider, watermelon, bag of peanuts, bag of popcorn, 3 waffles...
Facts and figures showing that Lucky Strike consistently pays higher prices to get the finer, the lighter, the naturally milder tobaccos. Now, I want to point out that many independent tobacco experts were present at those markets. They saw just what kind of tobacco Lucky Strike selected. And this is true at thousands of auctions all over the country. The independent tobacco buyers, auctioneers, and warehousemen are in a position to observe just who buys what tobacco and the prices paid. So here's a fact that surely says a lot to every smoker. Sworn records show that over twice as many independent tobacco experts smoke Lucky's exclusively as smoke all other cigarettes combined. Yes, with men who know tobacco best, it's Lucky's 2-to-1. Have you tried a Lucky lately?
Thank you, Mr. Cross. Tonight, Lucky Strike has sent out a total of $75 and 3 sets of the Encyclopedia Britannica. Our profound thanks to John O'Hara for keeping the appointment, if not in Samara, certainly in the studio. Next week, in addition to our anchor team of Adam, the other whom you've met before is Christopher Morley, actor and author, whose Kitty Foyle is now delighting movie fans all over the country. Incidentally, speaking of authors, we apologize to Miss Ayn Rand, the author of The Night of January 16th, for saying that it was not written by someone else. Remember, for every question we use, whether or not it is answered correctly, the sender gets $10. If the question stumps our experts, you not only get $25 more, but in addition, the complete 24-volume set of the Encyclopedia Britannica. Send letters with questions and the correct answers to Information, Please, 480 Lexington Avenue, New York City. And now...